From the Flint Hills Writing Project, this is The Suggestion Box, where teachers get ideas. I'm your host, Andrea Marshbank. Today we're here with Lisa Melton, who is an old mentor of mine, and she is a fifth grade teacher, and she is just phenomenal in every way, shape, or form. At a time in my life when I was a little bit new to the teaching field, and there's a learning curve there for sure, she helped me out in a lot of ways. So I'm so excited to have her on the podcast today, and she's going to talk to us about a challenge that her classroom was involved in. And all throughout this, we're going to really get into the details of how you too can be involved in the challenge. So Lisa, thank you so much for being here today.
Thanks for having me, Andrea. And don't sell yourself short. You were phenomenal even as a new teacher.
Oh, I remember some moments, but okay. You are too kind. Now, for any of our listeners out there, I now teach ninth grade, and Lisa's, like I said, classroom is fifth grade, and so I feel like the 4 years there, I don't know. I don't feel like my students are, I don't know. I was going to say they're more appropriate to like my teaching style, but I don't know. I think my ninth graders still would have been like, what is going on?
Well, and sometimes as they get older, they actually regress in age. So at least as their behavior progresses.
Absolutely. So we're here to talk about, let's start off maybe with the name, because I get a little nervous with like the ins and outs. So this is something that started with a movement that was inspired by Caine's Arcade. So could you tell us a little bit about like that process and the how social media has affected, like what is this project? Where was its inspiration?
Sure. There was a young man out in California. His name was Caine, and he had to go to work with his father. And as many kids experience when they're at work with their parents, they get bored and he needed something to do. So he used the cardboard boxes that his dad had at his garage and started to build an arcade. And he wanted people to come and play his arcade, but people did not. Mm-hmm. And one day a gentleman pulled up and paid for tickets. That man happened to be a filmmaker, and he actually, via social media, had what really was like a flash mob come and play his arcade. They had people from all over the world line up so Caine could experience success mm-hmm. with his arcade. And the video on YouTube is really inspiring. As I showed it to my students, they became very empowered. And that led, Caine's Arcade led to a lot of people recognizing that the creativity and the problem solving and the critical thinking that goes along with building, adjusting, designing, reevaluating, failing at a project is very valuable. Mm-hmm. And imagination.org started the global challenges.
That's awesome. So imagination.org connected with this independent filmmaker and they were able to start the challenge. And what is, so it's hashtag global challenge, is that right?
I think so.
Okay. And then it kind of evolves into like separate kind of branches of different challenges. And the one that your classroom focused on specifically was the hashtag cardboard challenge.
We did. We began with the cardboard challenge in October.
Awesome. I really like what you said earlier about like the experience of failing. I love that so much, the importance of that. I was watching a TED talk earlier this week about this woman who's become really famous on the internet for creating stupid robots. Have you seen her?
I haven't seen it, but now I'm going to have to go home and look at that.
Yes. Her whole YouTube video is like it's all about these dumb robots that she builds, and she went and did a TED talk on how like it was too much pressure to create something well, so she just focused on making bad things and then got really good at making robots. So that's what this makes me think of in a lot of ways. Yeah, that's awesome. So how did you come across the cardboard challenge?
Well, you know, I was at a workshop a year ago in the summer, and it was a tech teacher from Wichita, and she was talking about the global challenges. Mm-hmm. And they had brought that into their school district and were using them. And we had several teachers from our building at the same conference, and we were really excited, and we said, let's do it. Mm-hmm. And it was really great because we coordinated with our fourth grade. So it was a fourth and fifth grade project. So the fourth grade did a smaller scale, and the fifth grade did a larger scale of the same challenge.
Okay, that's really great. I would love to hear, as we're going through this, if you could add any caveats to like what the fourth grade did so that our teachers can definitely modify it to what they need. That's great. The challenge itself What did that look like for the kids, for you?
Well, we put an all call out for cardboard, and the bigger the piece of cardboard, the better.
Yeah.
The fourth grade decided to build handheld arcade games.
Okay.
And so they needed small pieces of cardboard. Mm-hmm. We needed big pieces of cardboard. Our fifth graders needed to take it one step further and make fully functional to scale arcade games.
Nice.
So we needed refrigerator boxes,
yeah,
and great big packing boxes and things that you could make air hockey games out of and make pinball games out of, mm-hmm, and giant Plinkos. And so we had parents bring in cardboard. We connected with businesses that were throwing those things out and recycling them. We did some dumpster diving, I'll admit, to get some additional cardboard. We actually had some kids dumpster diving, although I didn't support that. But I was really glad they did. So we had all this cardboard come in, and the kids had 2 days to plan. And they were in random groups, so these weren't groups where they were working with their best friends. Mm-hmm. And they had to plan for 2 days what their game would look like. And they had 3 days to build. So for 3 days, our classrooms were disasters. We just left notes on the door to the custodian, said, don't worry, don't clean it, don't vacuum, we'll get it done.
Oh, man.
And kids brought in treasures from home to make their arcade game functional, yeah, mason jar lids and nails, and we had tape everywhere.
I love how you call them treasures. Like, that's really inspired.
Oh, yes.
Not,
I mean,
trash.
Oh, no. They were treasures. When a student found that the hole for their skeet ball was the same size as a mason jar lid that, yeah, they had at home, that was big stuff.
Yes.
So they were definitely treasures.
Oh, my goodness. I love that. How did your kids, when you introduced this to them and you showed them the video, the YouTube video, Caine's Arcade, which I'll try to link in the description box below for everybody who's listening, but if you just Google Caine's Arcade, it's going to pop right up. There's a whole series of information on it. But how did they, like, what was their reaction?
They were just empowered because, again, this was a young boy similar in age that started a movement. Mm-hmm. And this movement was, again, hands-on, motivating, engaging, and they saw that somebody could take something that was for pure enjoyment, mm-hmm, and make it fun for other people.
Isn't that so cool? That sounds exactly like I want to do with my entire life. Like, what a real world skill that you've taught your
kids.
Oh,
wouldn't that be great?
Yes. That's kind of the podcast in many ways. It's just me having a good time with teachers.
Oh, fantastic.
So you talked about like pinball, skee ball machines. What kinds of things did your students make that surprised you or that like really you were, I don't know, that just kind of like resonated?
Well, we did it. We have 3 fifth grade classes, and so we were all doing this project at the same time together. And so the things that kids made are from all 3 classes as I described them. But we had a group from one of the other classes that made a driving game. So they made the entire car out of cardboard that you could literally walk into the car, sit down, they had a cardboard steering wheel, and then they had set up a driving app on the iPad, and kids could sit down and pretend that they were driving the car with a fully movable cardboard steering wheel.
Oh my goodness.
We had another group of people from, again, another classroom who built an air hockey table, and they had all the little holes punched into the great big top of the table, just like a regular air hockey, and they had figured out how to rig a fan underneath so that cardboard hockey puck could go back and forth to the end. We had kids make the bear claw, and so again they had to figure out what they could use as a movable hand,
mm-hmm,
and so kids could literally grab the contents of the bear claw.
Yeah.
And they needed to make sure that they didn't grab too many things because,
yes,
again, not many people then would get to play,
right,
but at the same time not have it too hard.
Yeah.
And that's all that problem solving.
Mm-hmm.
Because not only did all the fifth graders and the fourth graders get to try out the different arcades, but our kindergarten buddies came.
Aww.
And they all did the played the arcade, as well as our music teacher, and he had a lot of fun also.
Good.
and we had Plinko, and we had a couple different pinball machines mm-hmm. that kids made. And again, these were kids that were working with a variety of kids that by October you really don't know mm-hmm. as well as maybe your best friend.
Right.
And that was the beauty, just watching these kids lay on the floor and manipulate different parts of the equipment.
Yeah.
And probably my favorite part was the group that was going to give up. They failed. Their little Plinko didn't work.
Oh, no.
The little tab that they were dropping fell out of the front. It wouldn't stay into the Plinko machine. And they were like, we're just done. And I said, you've got time to fix it.
Yeah.
And they're like, it's all right. We're done. It didn't work. And I said, we had a little talk about grit and perseverance and resilience, and they revised it, and it worked, and they felt so good. It was a really nice life lesson for not only that group, but for other groups also that
right.
were frustrated.
Oh, yeah. Well, and I think this sounds like a project that is going to maybe access a lot of students that aren't usually, like, in, you know, engaged by the normal, like, what we think of as, like, quote-unquote
exactly.
school. Like, we get different groups with this.
Exactly. It really meets the needs of all your diverse learners. Mm-hmm. Your students that are varied in intellectual ability, the ones that are varied by language barriers mm-hmm. or not language barriers. You have students that maybe have had maybe negative experiences in the past and have typically shut down at certain points.
Yeah.
And then we have kids that are just really turned off by projects that involve a pen and paper answer.
Yeah.
And so this really just got everybody excited. Mm-hmm. And again, the beauty was seeing how everybody is engaged. If you walked into the classroom during the time that we were building, every single kid was doing something.
Yeah, that's really yeah. inspiring. And I can't imagine, like, we're in Lisa's classroom right now, and it's with these gorgeous yellow walls and the circle tables, and you can tell that collaboration is just an enormous part of it. And I can just picture students everywhere figuring out how things work. I'm a little, like, taken aback with, you know, like, a lot of these games, like you were talking about the Bear Claw, require, you know, like, some fundamental engineering knowledge. So did you pre-teach? Did you let them, like, as situations arose? Did you work with them one-on-one? How did you handle when they're like, I don't functionally understand how to make something happen? What happened then?
Well, we didn't do any engineering front loads mm-hmm. beforehand, but we do a STEM activity about every other week. Mm-hmm. And so kids were used to the process of designing and planning and revising and again, failing, because
yeah.
again, that's an important part. But the kids really came up on their own with the designs that they needed. Mm-hmm. And it was a matter of walking around and just making sure that if kids needed me, I was there,
mm-hmm.
but they rarely needed me.
Yeah.
And that was awesome.
That's really great. So I'm thinking a little bit about functionality. So you talked about they created a car that was, you know, large enough for students to get into. Did you created it in the classroom? Did they remain in the classroom? Like, they didn't have to go through doors or anything?
They remained in the classroom.
Okay.
And so at the end, we did a gallery walk, and you walked into everybody else's classrooms. And so if they needed to build it, we have pods with areas outside of our pod. If they needed to do any cutting and had needed some workspace outside of the classroom, they took it. But all of the different arcade games had to fit in the classroom.
Mm-hmm.
So for 3 days, like I said, we had to really adjust and not really have a normal classroom setup,
yes.
so to speak, while we were building. The hardest part was deciding what to do with them at the end, because they had worked on them in teams, mm-hmm. and of course they all wanted them, but they can't happen that way.
Yeah. How was that resolved? I'm like super, like, I can imagine the drama of that.
Well, the fourth graders got to take theirs home because they were handheld.
Yes.
But we recycled the fifth grade arcade games, and we decided that unless they could figure that out, rock, paper, scissors, that we would just go ahead and recycle
yeah.
the materials.
Yeah.
So it worked out.
That's good. That's good. So compared to how, like, when you discovered this project at a conference and you had talked about it with the people around you and about getting it started, what did you envision this whole experience looking like versus how it did actually look like? Like, were there any discrepancies there?
The biggest difference is the disruption to your classroom,
mm-hmm.
because when you're sitting among, again, these enormous pinball machines mm-hmm. made out of cardboard, it's hard to focus on math when it's math time.
Oh,
and
yeah.
the kids want to work on them all the time. And so we had to really be flexible and to understand that. Even if that meant if it's nice enough to go outside and do math so mm-hmm. you're not surrounded by the cardboard and the mess and the urge to want to want to focus on the actual arcade, because we did teach other things during the day.
Yeah.
And we just assigned a certain period of time to do the building. But so we really had to be flexible, because I didn't really factor that in mm-hmm. on how distracting it would be to the other subjects for those 3 days.
Right.
And the other thing that was very different was the connection to other countries. I've never done that before.
Can you tell us more about that?
Sure. We have a fantastic learning coach, Camille Wheeler, and she volunteered to be the point person. So if you actually formally sign up for the Global Challenges, you have access to people from all over the world that are doing the same thing. Mm-hmm. So anybody can do a Global Challenge, but signing up, again, connects you to people across the world.
And that's through that information.org.
Imagination.org.
I'm sorry. Thank you. Imagination. Information. That's not nearly as good. Okay.
And so she connected with Swalearn in Puducherry, India. And I'm hoping that I didn't butcher that too much. And there was a 15-hour time difference. Mm-hmm. And so we couldn't do, so to speak, a live Skype. Yeah. We had to send Skype videos mm-hmm. back and forth. They had people ages 8 to 20 come from nearby villages to participate
oh.
in their cardboard challenge. That's cool. And so they sent videos and talked about using English, mm-hmm. Talked about what they built and why, and then we sent a video back of what we built and why. And it was so interesting to see that though we're separated by miles and cultural traditions and ages in this case, mm-hmm. we are all alike in many ways. Mm-hmm. And that was great to see.
That's I think that's great. I can't, I'm thinking back to my own elementary school experience, because as teachers, you know, we often reflect on our own learning, and even as like people just like in the world, right? Everybody's been through some sort of schooling, and so we have so much to pull on. And I don't know that we ever did anything that had such an authentic audience or was so like engaging. I imagine that you just created like an experience that these kids will never forget. Like, what was there, like, throughout? So we talked about at the initial, they were empowered and they were invigorated. And how was it when they saw, like, other people using their arcades that they had created?
Oh, they were proud. They were so proud. They had an opportunity, again, to go and try out everybody else's, but they really wanted to hang around theirs mm-hmm. to see how kids were reacting to what they had built and to watch them having fun yeah. and to explain something that maybe didn't need to be explained, but they wanted to make sure that their face was associated with their game,
yes.
Especially the ones that had really thought outside the box and had built something that was a little extra
mm-hmm.
Creative and really had thought through things in a different way.
Yeah.
So they were excited. And the best part is when you can create a learning environment where kids don't know they're learning
mm-hmm.
and they think they're just having fun.
Yeah. I think that kind of slides right into the next topic of like, so what kind of, like, as an educator, what kind of skills did you see students develop from this very, you know, out, like this whole unit is very out of the box. Like, what kind of things did they gain from this?
Again, we talk a lot about grit and resilience and perseverance. They seem to be buzzwords right now in education, mm-hmm. but those are really life skills. Mm-hmm. And if we don't practice them at a very early age, if we don't give kids an opportunity to do critical thinking and to problem solve and, again, to fail, and I'll use that over and over again mm-hmm. because it's safe
yeah.
to fail in school creating an arcade, for example,
right?
Because then you have the opportunity to fix it, and that's what kids need to see. And so so we've practiced that,
yeah.
and then we practiced it after we did the cardboard challenge. We did a gingerbread challenge, and we, you know, we'd done other things throughout the year that that tried to practice those critical thinking skills, and again, giving kids the opportunity to fix what didn't work.
Yeah, absolutely. And I'm going to jump on the gingerbread challenge in just a second, but I want to backpedal to, like, I'm really interested in this culture of, like, failing is a safe thing to do, because I think that that's something, like, even, you know, teaching ninth grade, our students struggle. There's a lot of learned helplessness, and I don't want to pin this on, like, this generation, because I think this is something that society and humanity just goes through constantly. Sure. Like, we all have to battle with, like, you know, if we got really stuck, what's our next step, or is there no next step? Do we quit? And so how do you, in your classroom, create a culture of, like, you know, a culture, I want to say a culture of failure, but that sounds like, even in my head, I'm like, oh, that sounds right, rough. Like, a culture of, like, overcoming challenges.
I want to be in that class, the one where they like to fail. Again, it's the feeling that it's a safe room. Mm-hmm. And that means that people aren't laughing at you if yours doesn't work. Mm-hmm. It means that the expectation is that if it doesn't work, that you revamp it. Mm-hmm. I think that goes back to that old adage that nobody rises to low expectations. And some kids are just happy with being finished, and to give them the expectation that being finished isn't the outcome. Mm-hmm. It's reaching the goal that they set, whatever that goal might be. And that's whether or not it's some sort of a open-ended challenge, or whether or not that's an academic goal that they set for themselves. And so you reach high, and if you don't reach your goal, then what do you need to change to reach your goal, and how can you constantly do your best?
So that's a really interesting discussion of the goal and the doing your best and of constantly pushing forward. So it brings me to, you know, this question of, how did you handle the grading for this? What was that like?
You know, this was our first global challenge, and so the only grade they got was under their behavior grade. And it was, there's something on the grade card in fifth grade called, like, works well in groups, you know, with peers. And there's another one that's similar to that. And that's all that we graded it on. There isn't just a straight problem solving grade. And we really looked at this as not a standard that's on the grade card. We looked at it as a standard in our mind that helped us reach all of the other standards, which again was the problem solving and the being able to work through that creative process and the critical thinking. Because really, that's where our social studies standards are at. We're really headed in that direction and have been for quite a while, actually. But this is a great vehicle to practice those skills. So it wasn't a standard grade, like a 90, 80, 70, 60, something that you can put down. And so we really felt like that it was so worthwhile that we really didn't need to have a set rubric that had, again, some sort of a grade attached to it, that the experience itself was valuable.
Ooh, I like that. The experience itself is valuable. I think sometimes we forget that.
Absolutely.
Yeah. And I think as our students get older and get a little more focused on, and I say older, like, I'm sure you have some serious, like, obstacles with this, where students are so focused on, like, point values.
Yes.
Oh yeah.
Yes. Yeah. Students and parents alike. And again, I think that's sort of a systemic issue. But it is, and it starts young, because by the time they get to high school, they're looking for a certain GPA to get into that college, and that's really important. And so some people are very focused on that.
Yeah, it's a whole thing. So talking about the experience is valuable, do you think that the community, so you did this in October. Was the community in your classroom, like, did it feel stronger after this experience? Could you tell?
I think that some of the partnerships that were formed, the unusual partnerships, because we literally pulled sticks with kids' names on them to form groups. I think those partnerships really let people know that everybody has strengths in a different area. And wow, what a nice message that is. There's an old adage. It says that we're all gifted. Some just open their packages earlier than others. And the message, again, is that we just all have an area of strength. And so, for example, my student that is a really high achieving academic student worked with two students that had IEPs, and they were a beautiful group, successful, worked well together. Mm-hmm. And again, those students that had IEPs, they were IEPs for what I would consider traditional academic subjects. Mm-hmm. Boy, were they creative. Yeah. And boy, did they have something to offer. And they worked in harmony.
That's awesome. That's so cool. I think that when we really access project-based learning, that's the ideal, is that we'll be able to, because that's, you know, I feel like that's, it's just, it's so important that we have parts of the school day that don't look like every other part of the school day.
Yes.
You know, we need to prepare them for lots of different scenarios in their life. And, you know, a part of that is like when you go to work, there are times, no matter what job, where you need to be quiet and listen. And then there are times where you've got like a plethora of freedom and you got to figure out what to do with it. And so this is awesome that you enabled that. So going throughout your day, you talked about you still taught other subjects.
Yes.
What was your, so you had 3 days where you worked on this. What was the timeline for this? Did you have like checkpoints? Did you have, how much time did you allocate each day?
We did it in the afternoon because if we did it in the morning, we felt like kids would really lose focus for the other traditional subjects. We taught reading and math, and then we had the global challenge in the afternoon. And so we had really 2.5 days to build. I said three, but we have a shortened day on Wednesdays. And so they had about 1.5 hours each day, mm-hmm. 2 hours on the last day to build.
That makes sense.
Yeah.
Was that enough time, or do you feel like if you, will you, when you, if, when you do it next year, are you going to change that timeline at all?
No, I wouldn't change the timeline, but what I would do is, probably do a better job at making sure that kids were starting to try their product earlier and revamp, redo mm-hmm. earlier, because I think that there were some groups that, I know that there were some groups that didn't know until right at the very end that mm-hmm. theirs wasn't working,
right.
Because you can't make it open-ended. Yeah. Kids would never finish if you did.
Absolutely.
And so I think that would be the most important thing. If I said, okay, today is the, we're going to build the prototype,
mm-hmm.
tomorrow is the revision,
yeah,
and then Friday is the final product.
Right. I think that there's a lot of power for doing, like you said, like kids, any student, any person will take as long as they're given.
Yes.
And I think that I have a bad habit of making projects maybe a little bit too long. Like I see all of the opportunities and I want my students to have all of them. But I think that maybe the key is accessing more of what you did, where you make them just like a little shorter than the kids want them to be. So they're like, oh, I wish we could have done that forever. Cause then they've got this excitement that you can hold on to.
Right.
It's like a really good movie or like a great board game. Like it ends just a little too early. So we kind of touched very briefly on the gingerbread challenge. And so we know you did the cardboard challenge in October and that went well with your connection with students in India. And then what happened with the gingerbread challenge?
Oh gosh, the gingerbread challenge was right before winter break. And we did gingerbread houses mm-hmm. using math measurements in past years. And so I knew that that would be a really easy transition.
Yeah.
Again, we collaborated with our fourth grade teammates, and we decided that we were going to build Lawrence.
Oh.
And so we had the fourth grade teachers build the residential areas, and they included some of our old Victorian houses. So they had, again, small scale mm-hmm. houses. And then the fifth grade brainstormed what makes a community. You need a firehouse, and you need a wastewater treatment plant,
yes.
and you need a library. And so we talked about what would be the essential places. And then we talked about what makes Lawrence unique. For example, Ellen Fieldhouse.
Mm-hmm.
And so then, again, we had random groups, and kids then worked together to make these larger scale buildings.
Yeah.
And then we put them all together in one empty classroom. And when I mean empty, I don't mean empty like nobody uses it. I mean, we had some people, some support staff that moved out for a day and set up the entire classroom as our gingerbread village. And so we had, again, Allen Fieldhouse. We had Old Carnegie Library. Mm-hmm. We had a couple of the buildings downtown, like the Eldridge Hotel, mm-hmm. which is historic. And then we had our water treatment plant and our library and some of the other things that just aren't essential to have in a community, And again, then our residential areas and kids could come through and parents could come through. And it was, again, really exciting. Camille Wheeler came through again, and she connected my class to a class in Lithuania. And they, and we actually did live Skype, in that my kids, we had a group that volunteered to come before school started, and she had volunteers to stay after school ended so we could do a Skype that was in real time. And she, the gal in Lithuania, the teacher, made her students speak in English as practice.
Yes.
And so that was really fun to see, because they were really thinking through their words to make sure they were saying the right words. And they showed off what they were doing and why. And in the process, we actually Skyped with them a couple times. We learned that chocolate chip cookies are not readily available in Lithuania.
Oh, no.
They're available, but they're hard to get. So we decided to pack up chocolate chip cookies and become pen pals with them. Now, the chocolate chip cookies ended up being too expensive to mail.
No.
So, full disclosure, they didn't actually get them. But I made them. It was a good thought.
Good.
And then we became pen pals the rest of the year, and I made my students incorporate words from Lithuania into their letters. So they were also bringing in another language, because kids in other countries often speak more than one language, and kids in the United States often don't.
Yeah.
So we needed to make sure that they were doing their part in bringing in some of the language from the class in Lithuania.
That is so neat. Oh my goodness. Do you anticipate following through with similar things next year? Did the gingerbread challenge and the cardboard challenge, like, next year, will you try different challenges or the same ones? Like, how do you see that going?
Well, we've already talked about doing the cardboard challenge and the gingerbread challenge. The other challenge that we did not do was around Environmental Days and Earth Day. Mm-hmm. And we didn't do it because of state assessment testing and the reality that goes along with testing dates and the time and the excitement of the kids during the time when they were supposed to be focused, unfortunately. So, but we're going to bring in, we brought in something called interest-based projects for 2 weeks at the end of last year after state assessment testing was done, where kids got to choose different topics that teachers chose. For example, I did cooking, and somebody did yoga, and somebody did chess, and somebody else did coming up with sound effects to silent movies, and they were teacher driven, and then kids could decide how they wanted to learn a certain skill through which avenue. And so we did that for 2 weeks at the end of April last year, and that, and we're gonna do that this year also.
That's really great. It's almost like, it makes me think of like a conference for kids, right? Like, teachers are like, I can teach this really well.
It's exactly what it is. And the idea came from one of the Gemini schools, Megan Nagel, who is at a Gemini school in Newton. And that came from her. You know, teachers are a wealth of information, and we all get ideas from each other. And that's the beauty of the suggestion box, because you're providing teachers an avenue to get ideas. So I appreciate that.
Oh, thank you. I feel very good. And for any of our listeners who are in Kansas, we've talked about a little bit in previous episodes about the Kansas redesign project, and how, like, we have Gemini and Mercury schools led by Commissioner Watson, and all the, like, they're completely, like, turning education on its head to serve students better. And it's really inspiring to see. So make sure to listen to our past episodes. I'm trying to think of one in particular that has talk of Kansas redesign in my head, but I can't think of one off the top of my head. But I know that we have a conversation with Annie Brock and Heather Hundley coming up soon, who wrote The Growth Mindset Coach, and they both talked about it at length. So yeah, it's really great. Kansas is doing a lot of cool things with that. And this sounds so great. This is fantastic. I think that we've really, like, you have created the situation where students can access a kind of learning that they really should be, you know, earlier and more often.
It's what kids like and what kids need.
Yeah. That actually, I kind of brings up an interesting point. Do you feel like when we teach students, there are some teachers who are in the school of thought who very much think that, you know, school, it's not necessary for kids to like school. It's necessary for kids to do school. And I struggle with that in a lot of ways, because I think that life is about doing what you like finding the balance of, like, what do I like and what pays me money, right? Like, finding that nice place in between. So how do you feel like doing what students like? How does that affect your classroom positively or negatively? Like, we can talk about that.
Well, we know that kids that want to come to school perform better. Mm-hmm. And that kids that want to come to school generally miss fewer days. Mm-hmm. And so you're trying to reach all kids. That's the goal. And so the only way to do that is to have them at school. Mm-hmm. And the only way to do that is to have them engaged. And so it's important to come up with some different ideas that will get kids engaged. I don't think kids have to like school every day. Mm-hmm. I don't think kids have to like school every hour of the day. But I do think that they overall need to like school and to like what they're doing. But most importantly, I think they need to enjoy learning. Mm-hmm. That's that life skill, is that they understand that they don't know everything, and it's important to then go seek that information. And so if you can be a lifelong learner, then you're, I think, going to go further in whatever goals you have set ahead of you. And so, again, it's the enjoyment of learning. It doesn't have to be every hour of every day, but I think overall that you need to be able to provide opportunities that kids enjoy.
Yeah, absolutely. I don't think there's anybody that could have said that better. So in the process of lifelong learning, and this is more of a personal curiosity of mine, and in the process of the gingerbread challenge and the cardboard challenge, did you use Google at all to figure out problems or to like move through things? Or did you give them an opportunity to like use the internet to research how to make things? Like, how did that work?
That's an interesting question. We didn't take away their ability to use technology, mm-hmm. To go look for different ways to do things, but we also didn't encourage it. Mm-hmm. We really wanted kids to talk to each other, mm-hmm. and to really see if they could come up with a way to make certain things. Mm-hmm. I think that, and we have 10 computers in our room at all times. And this is a personalized learning classroom. And so we have the benefit of technology around kids all the time. And the temptation is that kids use it as a crutch, mm-hmm. to be able to give them the answers. Mm-hmm. And we really didn't want them to be told how to make an arcade. We wanted them to be able to, again, problem solve and create and think critically. And so we didn't say they couldn't, mm-hmm. but we didn't say now it's time to get out a computer and look at what Plinko looks like.
Yeah.
Instead, kids were like, oh, Plinko. Yeah. You know what I mean? I know what Plinko is.
Right.
Maybe I can do Plinko. And someone else said, you know, I played skeet ball. Let's do a skeet ball machine. And so, yeah, it wasn't a hands-off, and they weren't locked in any cabinet. But mm-hmm. they also, again, weren't encouraged.
Okay. That's really interesting, because I think that my initial reaction to a project like this would be to encourage them to Google. But I see a lot of value in the points that you're making, where it is maybe that conversation is important. Because have you ever heard of a trash to treasures project?
I have not.
It sounds, that's why when you use the word treasure, I latched onto it. It sounds similar, but different in a way. So it's this project idea that you take, it's part of kind of an Earth Day initiative. So that you take what is considered trash in your house and you recycle it to create something really cool. And
I love it.
Yeah. And when I was in a classroom, actually somebody had made a skee ball machine, and somebody had made, you know, like somebody was making a giraffe, and they were just making like all sorts of stuff. It was like a real quick kind of like invigorating project. And it was interesting, though, because I came over to students and I was like, hey, why did you pick to make a giraffe? And it was there, and it was almost a little superficial. It was a great classroom thing. And you know, you're not gonna, you know, maybe other students had different experiences, but she was like, you know, I just Googled things I can make with toilet paper rolls. And I was like, oh, I'm like, you're not like in love with giraffes? And she was like, and it was, you know, she still made a giraffe. Like, it was still really cool. But
yes.
I was like, that's maybe there are moments when we shouldn't tell kids to just Google it. Maybe
right.
That's a thing.
Yes. I think so. Sometimes we have to get back to, again, where we need to be, which, again, is to be able to think for ourselves.
Yeah. That's a good point.
Because you can find any answer on the internet.
Yeah. Yeah. But you need to be able to discern, like, what is your answer.
Yes.
Yeah. Absolutely. So I feel like we have a great picture of what this project looks like in your classroom and how it is enabled overall to give these students this really unique learning experience. But what advice would you give to teachers who want to try parts of this or all of this? Like, what could you tell them that would help them out?
My advice is to go to imagination.org and get some ideas and try it. Mm-hmm. Just try it. If you feel that you're unsure about wanting to actually formally sign up in case you might have to submit something, which you don't, just try it. What's the worst thing that could happen? Kids would have a ball.
Yeah.
That's the worst thing that could happen. And that they would learn that it was a little harder than it looks.
Yeah.
So just do it.
Well, thank you so much for being here, Lisa. I really appreciated this conversation. I feel invigorated. I want to go home and make something out of cardboard.
It's lots of fun.
Yeah. Thank you so much to our listeners of the Suggestion Box. We appreciate you so, so much. This has just been an amazing experience, and you, our listeners, really, really enable that. If you like the Suggestion Box, you like this episode, you like the idea of teachers teaching teachers and of collaboration across the nation with teachers, please subscribe. Leave us a review on iTunes. It really, really helps way more than you think it does. And, you know, well, maybe you know more than that. I should not cut you like no slack there. I'm sorry, listeners. But like, please leave a review on iTunes, subscribe. We're also on Google Play, SoundCloud, YouTube. Soon we'll be wherever you can get podcasts. Please, please listen. Let us know what you think. We are so eager to hear from you. Our email is thesuggestionboxpodcast@gmail.com. If you have an idea as a teacher that you think that other teachers could benefit from, that you'd like to suggest, a unit, a lesson, a strategy, you know, a technique, please contact us. Let us know. We'll do our absolute best to get an interview set up, to be involved, and to just create a wonderful interconnected community of teachers and of learning. So yeah, please follow us on all of our social media. We are on Instagram, Twitter, Facebook. It's all the Suggestion Box Podcast. So just search the Suggestion Box Podcast and we will pop right up. We have some active communities and we're here for you. So help us by interacting with us. Special thank you today to Dr. Heather and Roger Caswell, the directors of the Flint Hills Writing Project, who make this podcast happen every day. To also our magnificent, amazing, wonderful graphic designer, Kristen McGriff, and also to Sonic Tonic Audio, who create the intro and outro music for this. Also, a special thank you to Brendan Carney, who helped do our sound producer today. And of course, to Lisa. Thank you to Lisa for being here with us. See you next time, teachers.